Welcome student to our BSc first year compulsory English class, and today we are going to study a very wonderful poem. The name of our poem is Ode on Solitude by Alexander Pope. Now one side you will find the paragraphs from your poem, and on the other side difficult words are given to you. Now see the poem. Happy the man whose wish and care a few paternal acres bond, content to breathe his native air in his own ground, whose herds with milk, whose fields with bread, whose flocks supply him with attire, and whose trees in summer yield him shade in winter fire. So with the poem having a title Ode on Solitude, or uses words such as commentary, or the reader is a typically given a pretty idea of what the poem is about early on. Of course, it would be far too simple an analysis to say that Alexander Pope's oldest surviving poem, Ode on Solitude, is simply about solitude. But it does provide a solid starting point from which to analyze the poem. Clearly, when Pope wrote his work, he had the idea of solitude in mind, as do a great many poets who express themselves best through the written word, and perhaps less so in the company of others. Solitude itself is an important thing to attain from time to time, and perhaps it makes sense to think of one of the Pope's oldest poem as being about a very basic human desire. Now students, see the first paragraph. Now I am giving the explanation of our first paragraph. This first verse of Ode on Solitude begins the anthology that will carry through the poem, and seen through the life of an animus man who is described as being an ideal for happiness. His deepest desires, the narrator notes, extends a few acres of own land where he is content to live and work. The inclusion of the word parental suggests that the land belongs to this man by inheritance, and therefore belongs solely to him. Content to breathe his native air could also be a commentary on being happy with what a person has, rather than constantly wishing for more. And although this might not be quite as a significant an idea in 1700 when the poem was written, and as it may be interpreted today, the verse structure and rhyming pattern is established here. Three lines of eight syllables, each followed by one line of four syllables, rhyming in an ABAB pattern, and the final line lengthens to the five syllable. Now student, please see the second paragraph. Whose herds with milk, whose fields with bread, whose flocks supply him with attire, whose tree in summer yield him shade in winter fire. This verse simply means the man is self-sufficient. His land, now shown to be a farm, provides for all of his needs. His herds provides him with milk, and he is able to bake his own bread in the summer. His trees provides apple shade, and in the winter, the wood from those same trees can be lit to keep him warm, and he has no need of anything beyond his own land. While this verse read strangely as bread and shed do not rhyme, it is important to remember that Ode on Solitude was written over 300 years ago, and during this period in Britain, bread was pronounced with a longer vowel sound. While the word pronunciation is a difficult thing to estimate and predict throughout the different eras of history, it makes sense to believe that at one point bread and shed could be used as rhymes for one another. Now see the hard words here. Paternal acres receive or inherited from one's male parent leave and work on his paternal farm. Contain here means in a state of peaceful happiness. Native means belonging to a particular place by birth or origin. Herd means a large group of animals. Flock here means a group of animals, group of sheep, goats, geese. Attire here means clothes, especially fine or formal one. थोडक्यात इथे मराठीमध्ये सांगायचं म्हणजे एखाद्या व्यक्तीला सॉलिट्यूड म्हणजेच असा व्यक्ती की ज्याला खरोखरच वाटतंय की शांततेमध्ये एकांतेमध्ये सुद्धा आपण किती सुंदर लाईफ जगू शकतो. आणि तो म्हणतो की मला काहीच गरज नाहीये, मला सगळंच मिळालेलं आहे आणि मी शांतपणे आणि एक सुखी असं आनंदी जीवन जगू शकतो. आणि तिथेच त्याचे जे हॉर्स आहे त्याला मिल्क देतात, फील्ड्स ब्रेड देते, फ्लॉक्स त्याला कपडे फ्लॉक्स कडनं त्याला कपडे मिळतील आणि ट्रीज सुद्धा समरमध्ये वगैरे विंटरमध्ये समरमध्ये शेड देतील आणि विंटरमध्ये फायर. नाउ सी द नेक्स्ट पॅरेग्राफ. ब्लेस्ड हू कॅन अनकन्सर्नली फाइंड अवर्स डेज अँड इयर्स स्लाइड सॉफ्ट अवे इन हेल्थ ऑफ बॉडी, पीस ऑफ माइंड अँड क्वाइट बाय डे. Difficult words are given here. Blessed here means blessing. Unconcernedly means aloof, detached, disinterested, incurious and indifferent. Recreation here means an activity of leisure. Innocence, the state, quality or fact of being innocent of crime or offense. Meditation here means the act of giving your attention to only one thing, either as a religious activity or as a way of becoming calm and relaxed. So again here, the explanation of this third stanza, the narrator consider this farmer bless, time almost doesn't having meaning. For this man, his world provides for all of his needs. Hours go by, days go by, years go by, and everything remains the same. The health, the man is in at the beginning of this cycle is the health he remains in when it is finished. And peace of mind is a normal for him. What is there to trouble him? It seems as though in a world of peace and quiet, there is absolutely nothing that could disrupt the life of the farmer. And the narrator sees that as a high blessing. Now see the next paragraph. Sound sleep by night, study and ease, together fix sweet creation and innocence with most does please with meditation. Now this is the next stanza, and in this stanza again we find that this verse is the start of the final lines, and being five syllables long and continues the sentiment of verse before it. The idea of innocence is introduced here. And fair a way to describe a man who lives his life in isolation. He is innocent, which means he himself probably doesn't appreciate the kind of life he needs in the same way the narrator, author or reader does. It's a strange idea and casts the character of the farmer in a different light. He could in fact be viewed as a native and ignorant individual, one who simply doesn't know enough about the world, or he could be viewed as a living the ideal life. नाव सी द नेक्स्ट स्टांजा. आणि थोडक्यात इथे मराठीमध्ये सांगायचं म्हणजे की त्याला असं वाटतं की सगळे ब्लेसिंग्स मला मिळालेले आहेत अँड आणि हे सगळं जे अवर्स डे इयर्स स्लाइड सॉफ्ट अवे इन हेल्थ ऑफ बॉडी पीस ऑफ माइंड क्वाइट बाय डे, हे सगळ्या गोष्टी असून सुद्धा आपल्याला आपलं एक हेल्दी लाईफ जगणं गरजेचं आहे, जिथे हेल्थ ऑफ बॉडी अँड माइंड ऑफ पीस या गोष्टी आवश्यक आहे आणि त्याचबरोबर साऊंड स्लीप. Now in the next slide, this is the last stanza. Let me live unseen, unknown, thus unlamented let me die, steal from the world and not a stone tell where I lie. So student, ही फार महत्वाचे लाइनिंग्स आहे आणि हे आन्सर मध्ये सुद्धा तुम्ही कोटेड करू शकता. The meaning of this line, the narrator of the poem clearly agrees with the latter of the above sentiments. Here he wishes for escapism, escape, and begs for an unseen life where he may live in solitude until his dying days, and which will come and go unnoticed, unremarked, unadored, perfect life of solitude and peace. So in this way त्यांना असं वाटतं की शेवटचा जो अंत सुद्धा आहे तो सुद्धा कोणाला माहिती व्हायला नको आणि त्यांना असं अननोन अनसीन अनलॅमेंटेड डेथ हवा आहे अँड स्टील फ्रॉम द वर्ल्ड अँड नॉट अ स्टोन आणि सिक्रेटली त्यांना या जगाचा निरोप घ्यायचा आहे टेल वेअर आय लाय. सो दिस इज अ व्हेरी ब्युटिफुल एंडिंग ऑफ दिस पोएम बाय अलेक्झांडर पॉप. So see the difficult words here again. Unseen here means not seen or noticed. Unknown means not known or familiar. Unlamented means not means regretted or review over. Still means to come or go secretly. So in this way we completed our wonderful poem, Ode on Solitude. Thank you.